A brave and optimistic Chinese scientist named Wan Hu? Tied 47 gunpowder rockets to the back of a chair, took a seat and asked someone to ignite the rockets for him. Unfortunately, one misfired, they had accidents then.
What a lunatic.
The whole thing went up and the scientist was never seen again.
Wan Hu.
And funnily enough, it might just have looked something like that.
That's just my version of
Wan Hu's rocket.
And these are all the rockets?
47 gunpowder rockets. You didn't count them all now to be here all day.
I don't think I'd like to sit on that, though,
The funny thing is, of course, that any rockets, whether they were the rockets that he supposedly invented,
right,
the Chinese invented, or even the giant solid fuel boosters that NASA use, they are the same type of rocket
that we use.
They're a little bit more sophisticated. They wouldn't set one off those off in your back garden.
Right.
Well, fireworks are a little bit dangerous, aren't they? I was a bit worried.
Well,
about those,
unfortunately, yes, we say every year, of course, so we don't like having to keep saying, but every year there are accidents.
Right.
So, although it won't let you spoil your fun, but you've got to obey a few rules. Otherwise, there's going to be a few more nasty accidents. Firstly, always keep the fireworks in a secure container.
But when you buy fireworks, they come in like a flimsy packet. Is it best to take them out of there and put them into
personally,
a tin?
Yes. I'd put them into a metal tin, or if you've got a cardboard box, put that into a bigger cardboard box and just take one out at a time.
I've got you. We talked about rockets a minute ago, and we've got one here. Now, I think these are the ideal things. This is what I would use to set them off.
Well, unfortunately, I put those there to show you you're wrong, because the first British man in space flight failed when the bottle fell over. That's what unfortunately can happen, and rockets, instead of going up, go that way.
I've got
and
you.
Be very dangerous. There's also the possibility the hot gases could crack the bottle.
So what do we use?
Far better. Walk this way.
Follow you, sir.
Find a nice secure post, like a fence post. There's not many fence posts in the middle here, so we've had to put one up. Put a couple of large screw eyes in.
Now, this is something we can simply do at home, isn't it?
Oh, yes. I mean, even a couple of wire bonds around it would do, but I suspect most tool sheds have got some screw eyes in it.
Right.
Then you can safely put the rocket there, and you'll know where it's going to go, like straight up.
Straight up.
Sure, try it.
Yeah, why not? Good idea. I'm going to stand well back.
Now, yes, we've got to stand well back.
Side.
You can use a taper, ideally, or a box of safety matches. Get somebody responsible,
right,
I suppose that's me, to light them. Very carefully light them.
There
now,
I'm going.
Stand well clear.
Way! All the Duran fans went mad out there. Gee, that was very good, actually. But I mean, what about the other aspects of it? I mean, we talked about like rockets. I mean, things like Catherine wheels.
Let's try another one. Now, out the box, put the lid back on again.
Right.
You can use your same post. Need a hammer this time. Your fence post on's very secure.
Shall I hold the other side of it?
Right.
There we go.
Now, very important, otherwise the Catherine wheel's going to look a little bit silly, make sure it spins properly. Shall we try this one?
Yeah, go on, why not? So it's got a little bit of room to play with?
Yep.
All right.
Make sure it doesn't foul anything.
They do worry me, actually. I think I'm much better
now,
with the sparklers.
Stand well clear.
And there she goes.
I think we've had a misfire.
We've got a cath wheel. The rin's not working. Oh, yes, Nick.
Is it going to go?
Is it going to go?
Well, no, it all goes to show, actually, that, in fact, things can go wrong.
Well, when things do go wrong, I mean, a situation like this, what should you do? Do you have water? Or
leave it.
Just when leave it?
Yes. And if something actually misfires and doesn't start at all, go away for half an hour, at least, because there has been occasions when it looks like it's gone out, and, in fact, it hasn't.
And then it goes off.
It can be very, very dangerous, yes. Now, that one obviously burnt itself out. What's a good idea to have, of course, is a bucket of water.
Right.
And if you've got one, and I think most cars have these days, a fire extinguisher.
And they're
standing
easy
by.
To purchase, aren't
easy
they?
To
Bessie, for your safety. Now, the things like fountains and what have you.
Well, the Roman candle type of type of fire. Well, let's put that there. Now, again, I don't think I'd like it if we dug up the ground
here. BBC car park.
So let's take one of these ones out. Make sure it's nicely buried in the ground so it won't fall over.
All right.
Otherwise, your fountain will be...
Well, let's light this one. And, Matt, if you can do us a great favour.
Yeah.
Yeah, there she goes. And just repeat the instructions for everybody at home once again.
Well, always take care. Keep the fireworks in a box. Never fall about with the fireworks. Keep your pets inside. And have fun.
And there she goes. There's the firework code itself. They're available in most of the shops. And don't forget to read those instructions on the back of the pack very, very carefully. Have a lovely, safe bonfire night. And from me and Matt, We shall leave you in pieces. We right now go back to the studio. Dorothy was in earlier. She had her hair cut. How's it looking, Sarah?
Well, see what you think. This is the hair part done. Wendy's been working hard over the last half hour or so. What do you think of it, Dorothy?
Oh, it's great.
You like it? They've had, yeah. How many inches did you cut off altogether?
Quite a lot. Probably about 4 or 5 inches, I think.
And what else did you do?
Well, we've laid it through, cut it off into a bob sort of shape, and then I put loads of mousse in it and scratched it dry.
With your hands?
Yeah, with my hands. Just put loads of mousse. So it's really curled up a lot, hasn't it? Mm.
It's beautiful. Yes. And that'll hold, will it?
Yeah, it should hold really well. She should be able to just wake up and leave it, really.
Wake up and leave.
A
lovely thought. What do you think, Teresa?
She's improving.
She's improving. I think she's still a bit reserved in her compliments at the moment. What do you think, Karen?
I think she looks lovely. We've had such a funny time. Poor old Dorothy's been carted around. She had her hair washed in the bath.
She's had her hair dried in the corridor.
Oh, no, really?
But it's been
dear.
Good fun, hasn't it?
Yes.
Well, you see, you have to sound really beautiful, don't you, I suppose? That's the thing.
Yeah.
Well, to make yourself more beautiful. What about Ed? Now, yours is the next job. You're going to be doing the makeup.
Dorothy's got some set ideas about her makeup, but we'll give her a few sort of fresh ideas.
Oh, no, that's not
right. Yeah, she'll still feel comfortable, yeah.
Maybe, sometimes it's true, isn't it? Just very simple things that you've always done and you always stick to with habits of makeup. And just a slight difference can make an enormous amount of difference the way you look. Just a new idea you'd never have thought of. He's keeping his secrets to himself, isn't he? Maybe he'll whisper them in your ear. Well, we'll let you go away and get on with the makeup any minute now.
Just about to fall over.
Really, ambles in. Take it at your own pace.
I think it looks very good. Just a little more off the back here. That's what it looks. It looks great from here. See, you can't see this side. Right, while we're busy renovating, we've got some. Morning. Morning.
Morning.
Morning.
Morning.
I hate to ask what the B stands for. Morning. What does the B stand for? While we're. Morning.
Hello.
Morning. Yes.
Well,
wait. Morning. Yeah, good morning. We've got some cartoon. Good morning. We've got some cartoon fun coming up for you now. We've had loads of letters about Spider-Man. And Scott Mackay from Inverness says, I'd like to see Spider-Man. He sent me a little Spider-Man cartoon there. And also Andrea Taylor for all her friends. They're great Spider-Man fans. Good morning. Morning.
Now, web slinger. Say, Chameleon, your party sure ended with a bang. You lost because of an uninvited guest, the eighth little superhero.
Great. Love a bit of Spider-Man there. I've eventually cornered the fellow who's responsible for all these strange people who filed past me earlier on. Barry Sims. Good morning.
Good morning.
Now, who are this fine body of men behind
me? Oh, the 53 fellows we have here today. All come from Bristol and surrounding districts.
I daren't ask what the B stands for, but what does it stand for?
Bristol Barbershop, I would suggest.
Bristol Barbershop?
Barbershop.
Great. where do you get all these outfits from? Because they're all dressed exactly the same. I mean, how do you get a cobbler to make 53 pairs of those?
I plead guilty to that.
Oh, you're a cobbler? I didn't know it. Great. I think you look terrific. You look like, say, from a golf course, Troon Golf Course 1923, I think.
That's right, yes. Good team.
And you're going to sing a couple of songs. If only I could stay and join you, but I've got something else to do, I'm afraid. What are they actually called?
The Great Western Chorus.
The Great Western Chorus.
That's correct.
If you're sitting at home and you want to join in with this lot, now's your chance. Barry, see you in a minute.
Thank you very much.
Rubber ducky, I'm awfully fond of you, rubber ducky.
lucky you're so fine, and I'm so lucky that you're mine. Rubber ducky, I'm awfully fond of. Rubber ducky, I'd like a whole pond of. Rubber ducky, I'm awfully fond of you. Boo boo be doo doo. Boo boo be doo. Tell the dawn what sad flower you have on. Could it be a faded rose from days gone by? And did I hear you say he was to meet you here today, to take you to his mansion in the sky, in the sky? She's 41 and has two older baby. All the folks round about will say she's crazy. Got a small time tumble suitcase in her hand, looking for a mysterious target man.
In her younger days they call
in the sky, in the sky. Delta, 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 what's that flower you have on? A faded rose from days gone by. And did I hear say, sir, he was here today to take you to his mansion in the sky, in the sky. Delta, Dawn, what's that flower you have on? Could it be a faded rose from days gone by? And did I hear you say, he was with you here today to take you to his mansion in the sky, in the sky? To take you to his mansion in the sky, in the sky. To take you to his mansion in the sky, in the sky.
One for you. I'll take one off there. Take the hairs off my arms as well.
What hairs?
Yeah. There you go. You're all busy tonight as well, aren't you?
That's right.
Where are you off to?
Festival hall.
Oh, no. Cheers. Yeah. Thanks very much to everybody.
Thank you.
Mike's over there.
Right, I thought that was terrific, just like me in the bath, that, and he just with 52 more. I had a letter from four ladies, Angela, Carla, Nicola and Ingrid, who wrote to me from Northwest 2 in London. There are the four lovely ladies sitting here. And they've sent in this... this letter here whereby they swear to behave if they come in to see Duran Duran. If you could just raise your right hand in the air and... Could you do this? It says here... Oh, you can read it. Go on, read it yourselves.
We hereby swear to be good guests, trustworthy and normal. Signed.
Normal? Normal? You lot. Anyway, Simon and Nick had come in specially to see you. We made them sign and swear that they'd behave if they saw you as well, all right? Good morning, chaps.
Hello, how are you?
Thanks for popping in. All right, great. We're going to be seeing the video a bit later on. And you can chat to Simon and Nick on 01811 8055. And the ladies have got some questions, which makes it very easy for me. I just sit back and relax a little bit. Right, who are you, first of all?
Angela.
Angela, what's your question for me?
Simon would like to ask you, when you want to walk down the high street and just buy some clothes or something, do you ever wish you weren't famous?
Oh, not really, no. Because of the people who sort of stop me in the street, stop me and buy one. hey, you want to buy a shoe? No, not really. Well, in the town where I live, I'm quite a sort of familiar figure anyway. And because I often do go wandering around the high street on Saturday mornings and things. And people tend, they're used to me, so they don't really stop me at all.
That's right. Yes, in your own town, this is him again. I saw him down Tesco's just now, so they don't really bother. Your name is?
Nicola.
Nicola, right, have you got one?
And I'd like to ask Nick, now you're married, do you wish that you could just lead an ordinary life rather than being famous?
An ordinary life?
Yeah.
Oh, so now that he's married, it really doesn't make very much difference being married. But it's no fun leading just a very ordinary life. You have to have something different going on all the time. I'm a fidget, I'm a Gemini, and I like to do different things all the time.
It's good being a Gemini. Your wife gets married to two people. Right, what's your name?
I'd like, Ingrid. I'd like to ask Nick, what inspired your new single, Wild Boys?
Well, we really felt that we needed to do something different because the last few singles were from the Seven and the Ragged Tiger album, and this was the first new one.
and we used a new producer, Nile Rodgers, and we wanted to make a very powerful dance record. And there's a lot of music around at the moment that we were finding a little bit slow and ballady and wimpy. So yeah. We decided to make a much more powerful record. Yeah. And when we started writing it, it just happened very quickly, within, in fact, a couple of days.
Mm.
It was right at the end of a writing session, actually. We've been trying to write something else, which may appear on the next album, a song called Don't Look Back. And we've been working on it for about a week. And at the end of that week, Nick put a sequence on the synthesizer, and Roger really got banging away on the drums. And it was something totally spontaneous. We all sort of jumped on it because it was so different from anything we'd done before. And there was me sort of jumping around in the studio, and John knows when I'm jumping around, it's got to be okay.
Right, you've got a final question. You are?
Connor. Out of all the tours you've done, which is the one that you've most enjoyed?
Cool. The last
it's
one.
It's got to be the last one, yeah. It was the biggest one. I mean, you always enjoyed the last tour anyway. But that's the one. It was the first time we'd done a really big world tour, wasn't it? And it was so spectacular. We just had to make a film of it. Which is going to be out of Christmas. I'm not plugging anything, am I?
Okay, not at all. Well, I'm looking forward to it. Girls, thanks for your questions. We also got some bargains from last week, which you'd like to be. This is the
Limahl one. Limahl's question was, what was the longest running radio serial about everyday country folk? And the answer was.
Do you remember the answer?
That's right, Coronation Street. No, The Archers. And if you dip your hand in there, Simon, and pull one out, the LP, the poster, the shoes, the entire Limahl wardrobe will be going to...
Yeah, so it is The Archers. You did get it right. The prize will be actually going to Miss Joanne Morris of 49 Rydal Way, Clayton. Newcastle, under Lyme, Staffordshire.
OK, if you hang on to that, the Limahl good is on the way. That's the Limahl one. And the pop bargain, is this the pop bargain down here? Right. Oh, the bag's tearing down there. The pop bargain, what is the unit used to express the loudness of sound? The answer was decibel. Nick, maybe you could dip in there and pull one out. The prize of the paper construction book, the spooky horrors book, the top 10 and things like that, go to this person.
It goes to Miss H. Speed, 209 Underwood Lane, Crewe, Cheshire.
OK, if you hang on to that one.
This reminds me, actually, I'd like to say thank you to you guys and to Limahl and everybody else who sang happy birthday to me on Saturday.
Yes.
I was watching and I was so proud of myself.
Were you? Yes, isn't that nice? It was nice little birthday request. I've got the chest letter here somewhere, but I can't find it. Oh, is that it down there? Great, thanks. I'm pleased you came. It was like a job here. Right, the chest thing last week to go to Stockholm and see ABBA Studio. The competition was won by... Anatoly Karpov by Mark Preston of Dagenham in Essex, who's 15, so well done. He's out there at the moment, but he's just come back, so we should have some photographs of him out in ABBA's studio next week, which is great. OK, I think we maybe saw some shots of it there. Right, that's that. We got some fan mail from the girls here, haven't we? Nice. You got some bags of stuff there.
Yeah.
We had stacks and stacks of mail. If you sent the mail in for Duran, this is... This is just some of their Saturday shopping. So it's true they have got it all, so if you've sent something in, the group have now got it, and you can have the rest later.
Thank you.
You can take that down the high street with you next time you go. Yeah. Right, anyway.
I know.
You can chat to Simon and Nick on 01-811-8055.
And we are going on the telephone.
Yeah, you are.
trying to tell us that. We weren't going on.
Well, it's up to you. Come on if you want to. That's a fairly easygoing programme. Thank you very much, girls. You're going to stick around for the rest of the morning and help us a bit. Yeah. You still promise to behave?
Yes.
Right, and I can't wait for next week to see the pictures of the guy that won the chess contest out in Stockholm. That should be great fun. 01-811-8055 if you want to talk to Duran a bit later. Right now, it's time to whiz over to... Where are we going next? Oh, Sarah's next.
So what's happening next, Sarah?
Well, it's the audition news, the audition update, all right?
Yes, that's fine.
I'll see you a bit later. All right, thanks, Katie. Bye. That's right, it's the audition news about this search for a superstar. Congratulations, Manchester. You did it again. We got the largest turnout so far. Amongst the 200 acts, we had all sorts of people, a real good variety. And we were delighted that our old friend, Casey Lee Jollies, who came third in the finals last year, came to see us.
Tell me 50 years, I just want to let you bother.
entertained us with a breathtaking array of talent, and we'd like to say a very big thank you to everybody who waited so patiently till 9 o'clock at night to be seen. Everybody was great, and to the few of you who had to leave, we're very, very sorry. You see, it's very difficult to gauge how many people are going to turn up at all the different places, but please try and understand that we really do our best to see everyone. So, the message for everybody auditioning tomorrow is be there nice and early. We're going to be up in York tomorrow at the Vanbrugh Hall, York University, York, and we'll be there at 10, so make sure that you get there just before 10 if you can. And the following week, we're going to be in Welsh Wales, in Cardiff, at the Royal Hotel, St Mary's Street, Cardiff. There we are, the Royal Hotel, St Mary's Street, Cardiff, November the 11th, that is. That's not tomorrow, but the following Sunday. 10 a.m. till 7 p.m. Now, if you would like to see the inside story of the Superstore auditions, watch this space, because we'll be letting you in on a few secrets in a few weeks' time, so look out for that. Now I think we're going back down to the warehouse to see Keith.
I'm just having my 11s. Welcome down to the warehouse. Well, actually, we're in a different part of the warehouse this week, because this is the loading bay area where all the goods come in for the old Superstore. Actually, having this little counter here feels like I should be doing the Sussy Show, you know. Hello, sweet. Hello, Sussy. I think I'm going mad, you know. Anyway, welcome down to the warehouse, especially for Clipboard. And this is where we ask you to write in to see your favourite clips from BBC TV programmes. We've had a fair selection, I can tell you. And there's something, if I had the chance to write in, I'd love to see as well. Because Angela Kingston wrote in from Elstead in Surrey. She wrote in a little while ago, actually, to see something from the Royal Wedding. And unfortunately, we showed it, but they had a power cut in their area. So she's written in again, and she says, I can't wait till you show a clip from the Royal Wedding. I just hope we don't get another power cut. Well, fingers crossed for you. And fingers crossed also for Joanne. Joanne Hagen of Chatham in Kent. A nice, brightly coloured letter there, you can see. It says, to the Saturday Superstore, please could you show a clip from the Royal Wedding with all my love. Well, of course, coming up for you right now, that memorable day, Charles and Di. What a lovely day that was. It's one of those memorable days that for the rest of my life, I think I'll always know where I was and always remember what a smashing day it was too. All right, well, I'll tell you what, somebody remembers a little bit further back than that. In fact, to November 1963. In fact, to one of the first Doctor Who's. Because you've got two letters from the same area in Birmingham, from Acock Screen. One here from Mr. D.P. Shawnee. Please, could you possibly show a clip from one of the first Doctor Who's? And Richard Staten says, please, could you show a clip from one of the old Doctor Who programmes? I'm a great fan of the show itself. It will soon be its 21st anniversary. I think it would be a good idea to show an old clip on the TV. Well, we do go right back to 1963, to the first programme, in fact, and this lovely bit when the TARDIS takes off for the first time.
Grandfather, I won't leave the 20th century. I'd rather leave the TARDIS than you.
Now you're being sentimental and childish.
No, I mean it.
Very well. Then you must go with them. I'll open the door.
Are you coming, Susan? Oh, no, Grandfather, no!
Let me go.
No!
Get back to the ship, child. Hold it.
William Hartnell playing the first Doctor Who, and Richard kindly on the back of his letter sent us some of the well, ghastly monsters that have been on the series since it started. Look at that, there's a Cybermen down there, there's the Daleks. Some of them I don't remember, in fact. I always used to laugh when I was at home, because my mum, my dad and my brother and I still giggle about it, because when it came on the telly, Doctor Who, we used to go behind the sofa and sort of cringe and worry a little bit, and we wouldn't come out to the end of the show. It was always the Daleks that frightened me. OK, well, something, well, a little less frightening, in fact. One of my favourite programmes, narrated by Kenneth Williams, and Rebecca Howard of Dartford and Kent wrote in, says, Dick Heath, could you please show the beauty contest on Will-O-The-Wisp? Please, could you show the whole bits when they are judging? Well, especially for you, Rebecca, coming up right now, that little judging session where they're judging, well, I suppose you'd call them raving beauties.
Look at that! They're hussy! And look at them! I knew it! Now she's making eyes at them! That settles it.
Oh, look! Evil Edna's changed those poor judges into frogs, too. Oh, and one of them has something in his eye. And another. Oh, God, I do believe they're winking. And at me.
The frog judges thought Mavis Cruitt the most beautiful frog ever. And so Miss Murky Duckpond became beauty queen of the universe.
But I shall win next year. I shall turn the judges into nasty little television sets.
What an evil little lady she is, evil Edna. Well, if you're a fan of Will-O-The-Wisp, they're back on telly this Wednesday at 5:30 on BBC Two, so watch out for it. Cracking programme. OK, we'll keep any requests that you like coming to me at Clipboard. That's Saturday Superstore, BBC Television, London, W12, 8QT, and we'll try and do our best searching down the archives. Right now, at present, there's the address for you. Right now, at present, we go back upstairs and find out how Doc's got on.
Look at Dorothy now. Ed's been at work and he's done your face for you. What did you concentrate on, Ed?
We're just getting a sort of overall sort of feeling, you know, make it look fresh.
I have to say that it looks terribly simple to
me. Yeah.
You haven't gone in for a lot of different colours and everything. Was there any particular reason for that?
Yeah, I was talking to Dorothy about it and you know, she can go home and she can do this. Could have piled it on and she would have gone home, tried to do it and made a big mess, but this is quite simple to do.
You can be honest, Dorothy. Did you learn anything from the tips
that
Ed gave?
She has to say
yeah,
that.
No, I don't.
She's been attacking with that brush. She's been attacking everybody with that brush. What do you think, Teresa?
She looks lovely now.
Oh, there you are, you see. There you are. It was all worth it, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Now, the next stage is the clothes, and you've been in charge of that. What sort of time did you have shopping,
Well,
Karen?
We had a great time on Thursday. Yeah. It's really good. We went everywhere, all along Oxford Street, to Marks and Spencer's, Dorothy Perkins, Topshop, everywhere, and we ended up getting a really nice outfit from Next, which we're going to see in a minute.
So you're keeping that under wraps at
yes,
the moment.
Secret.
You're going away to put that on?
Yes.
Any minute. Well, we look forward to seeing you in your outfit, and then we'll have the complete transformation. Hello, Mr. Reed.
Complete transformations. They're going to be doing you next week.
I've been waiting. I've made enough hints. I tell you, I wouldn't mind.
You're coming on, aren't you?
Yes.
Yeah, looking good.
Looking gorgeous.
Great, we'll see the complete renovation a bit later. Well done to all the team here. Right now, we've got Tracy Ullman coming up, bit of music for you. This is her new single and her new video. This is called Helpless.
We love you, Tracy.
Situation.
That's a nice little gold you got. You got rain in it?
Oh, yeah, I've got it for free with 7 gallons of petrol.
Well, talking of cars, perfect introduction for our guest this morning, Derek Warwick, the Renault Formula One racing driver. And we've just recovered from being shaken about in the 1900 Renault that you're going to drive in the Brighton Run. But now another incident, an incident that Derek is very famous for, very unusual indeed. It happened to him in the 1982 British Grand Prix.
The fire extinguisher's gone off in Warwick's car. Derek Warwick's fire extinguisher. Now, this is a dreadful thing to happen because the fire extinguisher is icy cold and his legs will be frozen. He must be out of the race soon.
Yeah, well, the worst thing is he can't see where he's going. But if he just perseveres for a moment, the fire extinguisher... Dear, it's going on and on. It's obviously a long-life fire extinguisher.
I think Derek would rather be without it now. I mean, one of the McLaren fire extinguishers went off accidentally in the pits this week, and I put my hand in the frost that was generated, and I couldn't hold it there more than a few seconds. So what Derek Warwick must be like in that heavy Nomex outfit of his, I can't imagine.
Well, Derek, you imagine. What was it like?
Very cold. Now, when it went off, it caught me by surprise. I thought maybe a hose had broke or something. And then it was obviously very, very cold, and it was freezing my hand. And it was pointed to the right hand where you gear change, and the hand just went solid at that angle.
Oh, dear.
And afterwards, it took all the skin off the back of my hand.
But you did actually manage to continue long after that, didn't you?
Yeah, I was a little bit lucky, really, because I couldn't see a thing because the smoke was coming over the top of the helmet.
Not very good at 180 miles an hour,
is it? No, it's quite exciting. And luckily enough, I didn't go off the circuit. Kept off, and gradually it got less and less. And the worst thing was I put my hand out of the cockpit to try and get some life going into the hand. And, of course, with the cold air going through, it actually made it worse and not better.
Well, tell me, I mean, that's just an example. I mean, we think that, you know, driving a car around is not too bad. The physical discomforts of driving a Grand Prix car are immense, aren't they? When your neck...
Yes, right. Well, you straight away, you go into quite a strenuous routine of neck muscles and different other things. What you've got to remember is when you're in a Grand Prix car for 2 hours of a Grand Prix, you're strapped in very tight, so you get a lot of what are called dead leg. You know, your leg goes completely dead and pins and needles and things. And you just learn to develop the muscles that will overcome that.
Because I know, so all racing drivers have got this big neck, haven't
big
they?
Neck, yes.
Because when you're going around a corner fast, your neck's being pushed out of the car, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, you can be using something like 3G, and with like a 4 kilo helmet on, it can be very heavy. So the best thing you can do to train against this is testing.
Right. Pick up a phone. Let's have a few calls now. The first one is on line two, Dean Wolford. Morning, Dean. Can you hear me, Dean?
Hello, Derek.
Hello, Dean. How are you?
What's your question?
I would like to ask you what your fastest tyre change was, and can you remember what race it was in?
My fastest tyre change was actually at the last Grand Prix at Estoril in Portugal. We'd done it in something like 7.9 seconds.
Yeah.
and that was at the last race. So it was quite a good finish to the season, really.
It's amazing, isn't it, how tyre changes have improved. I mean, it's just incredible. Your heart, right. The wheels are hardly stopped.
I mean, before, I think the normal was about 12 seconds. And then with the fuel changes and tyre changes, people got quicker and quicker, and the way you done it got better and better. And now, like I say, people do it sometimes in practice in 6 seconds.
Right, Dean, thanks very much indeed for your call. On to line one, and David Green.
Hello.
Hello, David, what's your question?
Derek, what was your most frightening, greatest moments in Formula One racing?
One of my worst moments?
Yeah.
Well, I suppose the fire extinguisher was quite dodgy, really, but not in Formula One, but when I was racing in Formula 3, I was once testing at Goodwood, and there was no fire marshals or nothing there. And the car turned over, I hit the bank and turned over, the roll bar snapped, and I was trapped in the car for something like about 10 minutes. And because there was no marshals, I had to wait for my mechanics to remember that I was gone and come and dig me out. That was very frightening.
Could I have a signed autograph, please?
Yes, yeah, sure.
Could you say hello to my mum and dad and my brother and sister, please?
Hello, mum and dad.
Consider it done. Right, on to line five and Tina Nash. Yeah. Tina, what's your question?
Derek, now the racing season's over, what are you going to be doing with yourself?
Now, well, we now go into what's known as the winter programme. I go from this studio to 2 weeks of testing down at Paul Ricard in the south of France, where we test a lot of new stuff for the new car. Then the new car will be ready somewhere around about 2 weeks before Christmas. I go back down there and we run it just for a very short while, and then we get into the pre-season testing, which takes us to Brazil and South Africa before the actual season starts. So we're fairly busy over the winter period.
Fair to say that. Tina, thanks very much indeed.
Thank you.
OK, Derek, now. Okay. We're talking there about what it's like driving a Grand Prix car, and the margin for error, as you know more than anyone else, is very small. We've got some shots here of you in the Dallas Grand Prix this year, when actually the track was breaking up, and if you went too wide on the track, then things began to happen. What happened actually here?
Well, here
This is you behind
Nigel. Nigel was leading the race, and I decided to overtake him. Got a little bit too wide, car got sideways on the marbles and straight into the tyre barrier. There was actually nothing wrong with the car, other than the fact that it actually broke the left rear. So I started the car back up, but couldn't get out. See, it went a little bit left, a little bit too far left of Nigel. I got into the dust, round it went, and just no way, bang. I don't talk about Dallas if I can help it, because that was definitely my fault.
When you're in a spin like that, I mean, is there anything you can do? Do you just sit there and just wait for the impact, or can you...?
Other than close your eyes. No, you obviously opposite lock and try and get out of the spin, but when a racing car goes, it goes so quickly, you haven't really got any chance of bringing it back, unless you're lucky.
Fine. Well, you have a bargain for us today.
Yes,
and one that you haven't brought but will go.
Yes, right. Well, we've got an anorak, a cap, a model of an old vintage car, and also I'm giving away one of my helmets that I ran in the last three Grand Prix, a GPA helmet complete. And the question is, how old and when did I win the World Superstock Championship?
How old and when did you win the World Superstocks Championship? OK, Derek, thanks ever so much. And,
thanks very much.
Of course, all the best tomorrow. You'll need it in that car. I mean, dear, oh, dear.
It's going to be very cold.
So watch for Derek on the London to Brighton run tomorrow. Now, Keith.
Hey, thank you very much. Welcome down to the warehouse. OK, can you just bring it down, fellas? This is here for a very special reason, our little television this morning. I'll tell you about that in a minute. Crow's joined us down here as well. Morning, Crow.
Hello, Keith.
Nice to see you. Hey, you've hung around here. I mean, you're enjoying yourself on the show.
Yeah, it's a cracking place. It's warm, comfortable, great place to recuperate after my slight accident.
Oh, recuperate, very good. I was going to say, you're certainly looking well. I mean, you look better.
Oh yeah, I'm as fit as a fiddle. Oh, hey, Keith, knock,
what?
Knock.
Who's there?
Hatch.
Hatch who?
Oh, you've got a shocking cold there, haven't you?
Don't. Oh, please, Crow, I don't think I can stand it. Anyway, hey, you want to say hello to a few of your Crow friends who are watching, don't
oh,
you?
Oh, yeah. I want to say hello to all the Crowlets in Liverpool. All right, lads, Kiwi, Jimmy, Hoggy.
All right, seeing you're doing it, I'll say hello to Danny and Ben and also Elton, who are watching the programme down from Hastings. Right, well, the reason this is here is because if you're a sort of fanatical bird watcher, well, there's no reason to trample out into the woods this weekend, because on BBC television, there's a smashing edition of Birdwatch. They're going to be popping in and out of BBC programmes live throughout the day, and the programme comes from the West Country. This is the West Country, and hopefully down there at present, the man who's in charge of everything is Tony Soper. Good morning, Tony. Hello. Are you there?
Hello, Keith. Good morning.
Hello, where are you?
Well, incidentally, we don't need those crows around here. They're not very welcome. Well, I'm at the bottom end of the estuary. Quite near Exmouth, if you like.
So right.
Tripper town.
Well, we had a little chat last night on the phone. I hear the weather hasn't been too good for you, has it?
Well, it's been miserable, as a matter of fact. Very untypically Devon, you know, we haven't had the sun. But today, fortunately, it's come very nice. We've got a lovely, bright, clear day, which is, of course, what we need for seeing the birds out here.
So what is the weather going to be like tomorrow? What's the forecast, hopefully?
Well, with a bit of luck, this will stick, I hope. I mean, we've all got to say that. We're being optimistic about it, you see.
I'm laughing at the reason being is because you look as though you're in a wartime pillbox. I mean, where are you? What are you up to in there?
Well, it's a corrugated iron shed that's been built, actually, by the Teignbridge District Council. It is actually built by the local ratepayers, and they get good value from it, I'm bound to say. It's built on the back end of some sand dunes, because we've got the sea is out one side of us, in the far distance behind us, and then the other side of the hide, it's a beautiful big hide, as you can see, on the sheltered side, on the estuary side, we've got great acreages of sand flats, and then higher up there are mud flats.
Right,
so we're just sitting in that, and we've got a secret place where we can look out. We can see the birds and they can't see us, you see.
Yes, I can see to the, the left of you there, somebody's giving you a hand as well.
Oh, we've got a little bit of help. I am not the only person involved, I should say. Yeah.
Well, look, I mean, what makes the West Country, or the part of the world, the River Exe, where you are now, such an ideal place for spotting birds, then?
Well, it's time of year, really. I mean, if you come here in the spring, for instance, there isn't actually very much to see, very early summer. But we have a mild winter here. And the sort of birds which breed up in the Arctic, very much further north, where conditions are terrible at this time of year, they chuck it and come down here after the breeding season, come here because it's mild, relatively undisturbed, but most of all because there's bags of food. Because out on those sand flats, mud flats, there's a tremendous population of food, worms, shrimps and crabs, stuff like that. So you get, for instance, oyster catchers come here.
Yes, are they the oyster catchers at the moment?
This is an oyster catcher you've got on the screen there now, and he's actually on a mussel bed. This is the kind of picture we've got, we're getting. We've got oyster catchers trying to pick out mussels from the mussel bed. This one's actually just sort of sorting through them and trying to find a likely customer.
Oh, isn't that lovely? Well, apart from those sort of birds, what others can we see then?
Well, redshanks. This is a very typical estuary bird you've got in front of you now. Redshank. It's got a different technique, whereas the oyster catcher's got a jemmy for a bill. This one's much more delicate, and it picks off little mudhoppers and creatures, little tiny bits of meat, off the surface of the mud. Wet mud, they like that.
Right, so would I be right in saying, Tony, this is sort of like a junction for the birds, a stopping off place before they fly abroad?
Yes, very much so. I mean, there's always a lot of movement here. Greenshanks, you see, especially, these are birds which do tremendous journeys. These are coming, there are ducks coming, waders. It's a kind of spaghetti junction, really, of a lot of birds coming through here on their way somewhere else, and also quite a lot which stay for the winter. But these greenshanks, for instance, will move on soon.
How far afield do they travel? I mean, how far, where will they go to from here?
Well, I mean, a lot of them will start up in the Arctic tundra, not so much curlews, the ones you're looking at now. I mean, a lot of these curlews actually breed in Britain. But many of the other birds we're seeing down here start up in the high Arctic or in Russia, in Siberia, and they come here and use us for a little while and then go down to Africa. Or, you know, a long way. Some of them go to South America.
Gosh, that's quite a way, isn't it? Well, the all-important thing to ask you is, I mean, how do you manage to get your pictures without disturbing the birds, Tony?
Well, you know, you saw those Brent geese then, and they're not easy to do. As a matter of fact, we've done our best ones of them from the car park across at Exmouth. But we've also had some of the cameramen have been out in hides, which float up and down on the tide. And when the tide is out, of course, they're stuck on the mud, absolutely solid on the mud, and then they can look out through a slot. And get pictures. The other way we've done it is that we've got a fixed camera a remotely controlled camera which is out on a shingle bank. There you are.
Oh, there
you
it is.
You can see it. Now, that one has got no cameraman sitting there. It's out there because this is a bank where the birds come in when the tide brings them up. They're a little way away from it at the moment. But we can actually work that from inside the hide. Do you want to see how we do it?
Yeah, I'd love to. Come back in here then.
And across here, where Paul Cherry is, look. Paul is actually the brains one. You've got the brains now. He's actually operating with a little joystick here, the remote camera. So if he wiggles his joystick, so to speak, now perhaps we can show you the remote camera. There you go. We're actually doing that from inside the hide.
Oh, isn't that clever?
It's lovely, isn't it?
And it doesn't put the birds off, no?
No, they're not bothered by that. This is the picture, look, that we're seeing through it. That's condensation in the middle. We've got a bit of trouble, we may say. We're hoping that will get better during the day. That's what the lads are all saying.
So I could actually turn around to you now and say, go right. Go up. Whoa. Up.
Up, he says.
Up.
Up.
Oh, lovely
bit of cloud.
Down. Oh, lovely. Well,
You're enjoying that?
Yeah, I'm amazed. The programmes tomorrow are live, aren't they, right the way throughout the day?
Yes, that's
what sort of times of the day can we expect to see you?
Oh, we're on at 11-ish, and 11-ish, 2-ish, 4-ish. I forget the exact times, but 11:15, I think it is, and then 2:15, and around about 4, anyway. And then there's a roundup of all the best bits late in the night.
Lovely. So it's going to be quite a long day for you, then?
Yes, a long day, but a very exciting one, because when the tide comes in, all those birds will come near to us.
All right. Well, I know you've got Roger Lovegrove with you tomorrow, so good luck to you both, and have a smashing day.
Thank you, Keith.
OK, lovely. And I've got a little list of the times that you can expect to see Birdwatch. 11:50, 1:45, 3:40, and if you're a late-night person, like what I may not be, 11:30pm on BBC One. That's Birdwatch. Well worth a visit. Saves you trampling out into the woods, doesn't it? OK, we trample back upstairs now. Sarah!
Yes, Keith? We're here, and look who's here, the star of the morning, complete, her transformation finished. What do you think of the clothes? Do you like your clothes?
Oh, they're amazing, yeah, great.
How long did it take you to find those? You mentioned all the shops that you went to.
It took us a whole day, really, didn't it? Yeah. We tried everything on party dresses. The tuxedo looked nice on you, but the reason I think we went for this one was because the colour mauve is the colour for the autumn, and also, a bit of tartan for the trousers is really fashionable, plus the paisley tie and the big shawl. So it's very fashionable, yet not
looking
over the top.
It's a fashionable look. Is it something that you feel comfortable in?
Yes, because you don't feel overdressed, you know. You're just really
Is it the sort of thing that you would have gone for anyway, or would you have been a bit more
I don't think
laid
I'd
back
have had all the ideas. I mean, you've got so many people helping you, you know, do great ideas, sort of all pulled together. And it was marvellous. I was just being dressed.
Well, I have to tell you that we got a classic comment from one of our ace reporters this morning, Gareth. I don't know if you're going to like this so much, Teresa, but he said, I have to say it, you really can't tell which is the mum and which is the daughter. That's what he said. That's lovely. Are you pleased, Teresa?
Yeah. I think she looks lovely.
Well, I think thanks are due to you for nominating your mum and to Karen.
Oh,
yes, the moment. That's lovely. And to Karen, of course, who sort of set the whole thing up for us. And to Wendy and Ed, who've done the hair and the makeup. And now we've got to see the before and after picture, because we've kept the picture we took of you this morning of how you looked when you came in. And any minute now, we hope that we should be able to see the screen in half and you before your transformation and you after. A completely different person. Look at that. Would you like to give us a twirl? Give us a twirl. That's right. Gosh, that really does show it, doesn't it?
It does.
What a difference in the hair and everything. It all makes it. And it's quite good that you've got a new image, isn't it?
Yes, yeah.
What's happening on Monday?
Yes. New job.
New job, yeah, new image. Great. What are you going to do?
I'm working in a children's care centre, which is one of the first of its kind in the country.
Well, we wish you very, very good luck with that.
Special
and a little
surprise. Surprise.
No, really?
Wonderful. We think you look so attractive that while you're seeing the first video of the pop panel, which is level 42 and the chart has just begun, we're going to whisk you off somewhere because we think you look really tasty.
What are you going to do with me?
Sorry.
Thank you.
Level 42, who were on the store a couple of weeks ago, and the chant has just begun. We've got a whole array of noises to make, whether we like it or not this morning. Some great stuff here, all sorts of things. That's probably one of the best noises.
Already. He's singing right. The BBC's Ender.
Let's get on with the bit that counts. We're going to start Nick Rhodes' end, I think. Do you like that video? Are you a Level 42 fan?
I quite like them, actually. I think the bass player is great, but they're a bit complicated, I think, and I wasn't awfully keen on the video. It's OK. A bit average.
Oh, sorry, but you're a Mark King fan, obviously.
He's very good.
I like the band. Ooh.
Good.
I like the band very much, and I did like the record, and I like the video. I really liked it.
Good. It's a thumbs up from you, Derek.
I mean, the video, I mean, I didn't like it at all. The music was very good, and I liked it a lot, yes.
You did. Are you a record buyer?
Not really. My wife is, but I'm not really a music
man. In car stereo, maybe?
Yes.
200 miles an hour?
Yes. Very nice.
Right, Nick.
Mark King's on my album, you know.
Is he?
Yeah.
Your new album?
Yeah, I thought that impressed you.
Yeah, it does.
Which is out on November the 19th and available in most leading records shortly.
I know, yeah. I can trust you.
I like the song. It's the first track on the new album, but I'm not sure about the video. It looks like they just sort of implanted there. So, look, dance, you know, play a bit and these people will come and dance around you. So
not the video, but the song you like?
No, it doesn't look as though it was anything to do with them, actually.
OK, all right. Have you recovered yet, have you?
Oh, nearly, yes.
Nearly?
Yes. I like that video. You're all wrong. It was good.
It was
the song. I didn't understand what they were singing about, but the video sort of showed it.
They were chanting?
Sort of thing, yes.
Right. But you quite liked it. What are you going to do with that?
It didn't very long. Look, well, I'm not going to do that to the...
Well,
to
good,
the song, to the video. I'll do that to the song, OK?
It's a heck of a noise, isn't it?
Yeah.
Right, Teresa, what about you?
It's fine, great.
Yeah? You're a Level 42 fan?
Yeah.
Bought their records before?
Yeah.
What's your favourite? Have you got a favourite of theirs?
No, they're all good, I think.
Yeah?
Really good, I like them.
You like them? Mm. Well, that's pretty positive.
You mean nearly as much as Duran Duran?
Yes.
And Nick Kershaw, oh my God.
What are we going to do here? Terrible.
What do I think? Great bass playing. Video stinks.
Yeah, you don't want to elaborate on that. The song
is a little bit confusing, but it's not a bad song. I mean, Mark King is one of this world's absolute ace banana fabo bass players. Excellent, but he does pull some funny faces, doesn't he?
He does, yeah.
You notice that?
I've talked to him.
But that's all the real players. All the real players do that. He's grimace an awful lot, you see.
Yes, that's true.
Always wise to remember. That's what I always do, and I'm holding that one chord for half an hour.
Yeah, we saw the picture of you in the Radio 1 calendar, Mike. It's down there.
Oh, yeah, you saw that, didn't you?
Yeah. Oh, I did.
Right, talking of confusing, Level 42's The Chant Has Just Begun. The Alarm have a single out as well called The Chant Has Begun, and this is their video. And after this, we'll find out what the pop panel think of the new Alarm video and single. One of my favourite bands, The Alarm and The Chant Has Begun, although a change of direction from them, that's not quite as rowdy as normal. Simon?
Well, I'm a bit iffy about it. I mean, I don't rate the song that much. I like the chant bit, I think it's great. The chant bit of the song. Video, a bit predictable. I'm always very suspicious of people who wander around slag heaps wearing Ray-Bans, you know.
And
at the end of it, all those guys dressed up in evening suits, they burn them. And I don't quite understand it.
Maybe it's symbolic.
Symbolic. But burn the evening suits. OK, guys. Not bad. Not very good.
OK, Teresa?
I didn't like that at all.
No?
Not the video or the record.
Load of old rubbish.
Load of old rubbish. Yeah, I can't come on here saying it's a load of rubbish. Yeah, yeah. A load. Sorry, chaps.
What do you mean? You're talking to a star there.
Yeah, just a minute.
Yeah. You didn't like that then?
No, I didn't.
All right, that's honest of you. That's all right, hearing honest person on here. Nick.
Actually, the song's a grower. I've heard it two or three times.
It does grow on
you,
yeah.
It's really got to me, yeah. I'm not sure about the video. The trouble is, videos nowadays, unless they're amazing, they just wash over you because there's so many of them.
That's right.
It's just, and that washed over me.
It's a bit like records as well, really. There are so many records out now. Derek.
Absolutely. Well, for me, the video was the same. I thought it was rubbish and the song was even worse. For me, it's just not my kind of music at all.
It's not.
Are we showing our age?
That says it all.
Maybe.
Karen, you're going to say it's fabulous now.
No, I'm not. I didn't like it at all. I didn't like the videos. I didn't like anything about it. Sorry.
It's a good job that chaps live in Rill, because it's a long way to come down to kneel on you. Right, Nick.
Having seen all three of them, I thought it was the best one out of the three of them.
Right.
I shouldn't say that yet, should I? But, some of the editing I thought was quite nice, actually. Some great editing on accents in the songs. And although overall it's not that amazing.
I think
it's all right.
OK, well, I like it. Nick likes it. Apart from that, Simon, I think you better honk that.
Terrible.
Very good. OK, that's the alarm and the chant has begun. The third one is the Moody Blues, and this particular track, All the Money is Going to a Children's Fund. More about that in a moment.
Won't you take me back to school? I need to learn the golden rule. Won't you lay it on the line? I need to hear it just one more time. Oh, won't you tell me again? Oh, can you feel it? Oh, won't you tell me again tonight? Each and every heart, it seems, is bounded by a world of dreams. Each and every rising sun is greeted by a lonely one. Oh, won't you tell me again? Oh, can you feel it? Oh, won't you tell me again tonight? Tonight. 'Cause out on the ocean.
Moody Blues and The Voice, all the money's for that going to NSPCC charities. Having said that, doesn't mean you have to say necessarily nice things about it for that reason, but nice of the lads to do that. Anyway, Nick.
Well, I think it's a very gallant cause to send the money there, but I think it's also the worst video I've ever seen. I've never seen such... Those effects they're using, those video effects, I mean, they're things that I thought went out with Noah's Ark. I mean, it's just horrible, and I can't bear his haircut, I'm afraid. It's like, he's just been there for too long.
It was getting for renovation, right, Karen?
I don't like the song either.
You don't, right. No.
Maybe the video wasn't very good because they didn't want to spend too much money on it, because it was awful. Maybe they wanted to put the money to the charity. I quite like the record, though. I wouldn't buy it, but I liked it.
Derek?
I like the record a lot, actually. I quite like that kind of music. As far as the video is concerned, I think it's a nice contrast because I like sometimes to see the groups working and playing.
Right.
So I think it's good for that reason.
Nick?
Not really my cup of tea, actually. No, didn't like that much.
You're going to love it, aren't you?
I am.
I know you're going to love it. You were drooling over Justin Hayward. You go, Justin!
I've got everything they ever sang. It was one of those. Go on, do it. Yeah, no!
The other way.
The other way. It's wonderful. A bit predictable, but then they are all.
I think you rather really fancy Justin Hayward, don't you?
Yes, I've been in love with him ever since I was that big.
Ever since he was that big as well. Yeah. Right, Teresa.
I didn't like that at all.
You didn't.
Sorry, Mum.
I'll get you when you get home.
Me and Teresa are going to write a bitch about that. especially the haircuts.
That's terrible.
Somebody ought to tell the guy.
Simon.
I'm not particularly fond of it. I mean, I can see how it's made, how it's turned out like that. Somebody said, guys, you've just got to make a video. And they've said, well, we just don't want to spend a lot of time and money on it. Let's just go and do a live thing, which is all well and good, but it's very much kind of a sort of a lip service type thing, so it can go on the TVs and promote the song. Right. It obviously hasn't had a lot of thought and energy into it, and that's obviously where their heads are not at.
Oh, a very intelligent musician.
Yes.
And he's a terrific poet as well.
Yeah, but it doesn't show on the video.
No, but that doesn't matter. It becomes irrelevant, doesn't it?
Well, I think you're slightly biased on this.
Okay, listen. Okay.
Okay. Come on, I did give you a bunch of flowers.
Oh, all right, then, okay.
Yeah, but I paid for them.
Right. You've some very good songs.
A bargain, if somebody can hold that end. The bargain. The Duran Duran book, Luminous Poster, Wham Calendar, and the top 10, and all the bits you see down here on the table. The question this week, status quo, a 7 with The Wanderer. What's the full name of the artist who first had a hit with The Wanderer? Don't tell me if you know. Quo at 7 with The Wanderer, the full name of the artist who first had a hit with it. You could win this. All the bits and pieces on the table, the T-shirts, the records, the top 10 down there, and answers on a postcard to Saturday Superstore, BBC Television, London, W12, 8QT. Saturday Superstore, BBC Television, London, W12, 8QT. Thanks for your bits about the video. It's nice to see them all disagreeing. I love it when they do that. We'll be back in a moment with calls to Duran, Simon and Nick on 01811 8055. In the meantime, it's time to pop down to the warehouse and see Sarah and Keith.
Welcome to the loading bay area. Will you concentrate? We're on the telly.
I'm just getting used to this loading bay.
It's quite nice, isn't it? Crozier.
It's all right, I suppose.
It all happens down here. Yeah. This is where all the invoices
Stylish,
come in, you know.
Classy.
Do you know last week I was in the Isle of Man?
I do indeed.
We got so many thank yous and we had such a cracking time over there. Paula Waring wrote in from the Isle of Man, said thanks for coming over. She enjoyed the bluebells. Zoe McGowan wrote in, said thanks for coming for the Isle of Man. She had a great time in Castletown. And also David Graham. So thanks to you, David, for writing in as well. We've got loads of stuff here. What have you got?
Lovely bluebells. Well, I've got one of those funny pictures that Mike was talking about a couple of weeks ago, where you put a face on a different body, you know, and they did the ones of Peter Powell and et al. Well, this is one that's coming from Nicholas Luxton, who's a big Doctor Who fan, and he's written, Sarah Green is in Doctor Who, Attack of the Cybermen. Well, you've got it right, Nicholas, except that you put me as a Cyberman, and I actually play a goodie in Doctor Who, which is coming out. I think the one I'm in is in January 85. We're not sure, but we'll keep you posted on that. Mm. And I get bumped off by a Cyberman in the end. But I've told you, but I've given it all away. Oh dear, never mind. We'll keep you in touch with all that, Nicholas. Got a lovely crow picture here. Hey. This is from Caroline Peters Crow.
Too much, yeah.
And she says that she not only loves crow, she even likes my hair, so that's good. And how about this for a funny picture? This is Keith. Can we see that?
Oh,
Keith,
no.
Age 3 and a half, playing Robin Hood Jr.
In pea green tights.
Now, I've been sent that,
isn't that
by
amazing?
A lady called Heather Watt.
Because the length
in
of my hair?
Aberdeen.
Oh, isn't
Aberdeen.
That lovely?
That's good, isn't it?
I was about 15 then. Aww. Two very, very, very quick silly pics. Have a look at this. Have a look at this. It's come from Diane Bucknold. just look what it says. 1st of April to the 31st of October. And it's open Monday, Wednesdays and Fridays. Also Tuesdays and Thursdays. why didn't they just write all week? Look at this one, a very, very quick one from Joanne and Kerry Poulton, who found an ideal place to have a snooze. Nat Park Road. That is great.
Well, let's hope that old Mike isn't napping upstairs.
Yes, that's true.
He's got a lot of news upstairs.
Good
okay.
News. Hey, very, very quickly before you go, we've got a little something special for special occasions. If you've got a birthday coming up, or you think you could deservedly be on the television, send us a picture this way up and we'll try and do it for you. We're going to call it our Saturday special. So if you've got something special to tell us about it, then send us a picture postcard, but that way up. Okay.
All right, that's most important.
Just go that way up.
All right.
Bye.
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 Where are you?
I wasn't expecting you so soon. I was just having a sandwich and chatting to the guys.
No,
we're going to be taking calls on 01811 8055. You caught me out there. I was just having a napper. We're just talking about Justin Hayward's haircut. I was just saying what a nice chap he was. And the guy, you never met him, have you, actually?
No, I'm sure he is a nice chap.
Also, we've got a florist sent these in for you.
Right.
It's one for you and one for you. And there's also a carnation from somebody else, isn't there?
Yeah, I wish I could read your surname, I really do. I'd like to thank Stephanie for the carnation. Thanks very much. I'd also like to thank my next-door neighbours, John and Sheila, for being so kind of letting me park my car outside your front door.
That's nice when people do that, isn't it?
It is, it's wonderful.
Yeah. Being neighbourly and things. Right. Yeah. OK, well, we've all got our little flowers on here. What have we been up to this year? I know you've been touring the world. Has it been really chaotic. Is it funny? Is it disorientating to come back to England after thrashing around the world? Yeah, or is it happening?
Nice. It's the one thing you can. It's where you place where you can really settle down and relax and straighten out, find a balance. Mm. You know, I mean, the tour is ridiculous. The last tour we did, as you will see when you see the documentary.
Do you have any favourite places in the world that you visit? I mean, apart from England.
Yeah, I think New York is a general favourite.
With everybody.
Yeah. I'm not too keen on
me.
It. No. I like Sydney, Australia. So it's really good fun. I mean, I like going outside and I like water sports and fresh air.
Right.
You see.
Well,
you don't
much
get
of that
much
in
of that
York.
In New York, no.
No, that's rather good. So New York, Sydney, two favourite places. Is there anywhere in the world that you actually don't look forward to that you think, oh, can't stand going there again, but we've got to.
Plenty.
A few places that? Right in the middle of America.
Yeah.
Have to be the most boring places in the world. It's like,
nothing
just
to do.
Sit there. It's not even that there's nothing to do. It's like,
wow,
it's like recessive. Nothing at all. You feel like you're going backwards in time or something.
Quite good sometimes. Let's chat to a few people on the telephone. If you grab one of those each. Karen Lyles. Is it Lyles or Lilies?
Lyles.
Karen, you're through to Nick and Simon.
Hello, can I speak to Simon, please?
Hello, Karen.
Hello.
Hiya, babe. How you doing?
Can I ask you what you got for your birthday from the other members of the group?
From the other members of the group?
Yes.
I only got one present from the other members of the group. Everybody else forgot.
Oh.
Nick gave me what do you call it, hip flask. To carry my spirits high. I got a windsurfer for my birthday, which was a great birthday present.
Right.
So I'm going to be doing a lot of falling off in Rice at Lido soon.
And a donkey.
And a donkey. What should we call him?
Have you windsurfed so far or not?
Yes, I did. I went on holiday to Greece and did a lot of windsurfing there. It was a lot of good fun. A lot of falling in, though. You've got to be prepared to do it that way, believe me.
It weakens, isn't it? You go on about six times.
Yeah, you get
can't.
Pains right in the small of your back. It's dead. Painful.
Take the pins out of the wetsuit first. Thanks for your call.
Thank you.
Okay,
you
Cam, bye-bye.
Simon, could you give my friend Nikki a wave, please?
There's
Nikki, I can see you. Hi.
All right, bye-bye.
Big brother is
bye-bye.
Watching.
Bye.
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 Thank you.
Bye.
Janine Roldan. Hello, Janine.
Hi.
Hello, where are you calling from?
Liverpool.
Right through to Nick and Simon.
Hello, Simon. Was it a natural progression for your voice to go higher than the Wild Boys, and did you have to take lessons to get it like that?
Was it a natural progression?
Yeah.
I had Nile Rodgers sort of squeezed him into a very tight pair of trousers at the time. It was very difficult. It is quite high, that chorus, and it took a lot of work. But I think it's funny, I was talking to somebody the other day about it, how when you actually do perform, it gives you that extra burst of energy, which enables you to do things that you're not able to do in normal life. And in the studio, I just had to rely on that kind of adrenaline to get my voice up there. As for lessons, I think I had about two, but I couldn't stand the teacher.
Doesn't it hurt your voice? Does it strain it?
Pardon?
It sounds dead high now when you sing it. Does it strain your voice?
It's on the Wild Boys.
Yeah.
No, it's all right. It fits in quite nicely. You can always hear when voices strain because they kind of go all thin and stringy.
Is that okay?
Okay.
Mind you,
thanks
I've often
you call.
Been described as being a
bye.
Thin and stringy.
Bye. We had a letter in actually asking if you made provision at all for handicapped people at concerts. Are there actually places for handicapped people at concerts?
That can be arranged if people call beforehand, particularly.
Right.
Well, actually, I've seen shows where the people have come in, and I think we've had a party of about six who'd actually come down from a hospital where they all had broken legs and things, and some disabled people as well. And they just turned up, and what the organisers did, they took the seats out, and they actually gave them really nice seats at the front of the theatre. And because you can't put them, the wheelchairs in the aisle because it's a fire hazard.
Yeah.
So you actually have to remove seats to do it. But it's fine. I mean, it's like bringing your own seat with you, really, isn't it?
It's great. They can do that.
Yeah.
Great. We'll take some more calls in a second. But you've brought a bargain with you, haven't you?
Five bargains.
Actually, while you're digging that, I remember the picture here. Yes.
We have these sets. These are special, just kind of for anybody who likes collecting Duran gear. We've got these singles.
Yeah,
that'd be good.
Five of them, because there's five in the band. They all got pictures of different people on them. I mean, there's me, and John, and Nick, Roger, and Andy. They're going to be sort of on sale soon.
Smashing.
But we thought we'd give some sneak preview ones, so, you know, if anybody really is interested. And there's a dead simple question.
How many have you got to give away, though? You've got a whole pile of them.
Well, hang on, let's have a look.
Great.
We've got a whole pile,
yes. Count. I mean, rough count.
Yeah, so to the first...
However many.
First one, two...
First half.
Six. Yeah, first six correct answers to Nick's question, we will give you this.
What we want to know is which city does each member of the band come from?
Okay, which city does each member of the band come from? I think you've probably only got three cities to write down as a clue, right?
We'll tell the answer.
He's got to give him a clue. He's not making it easy at all. So which city does each member of the band come from?
And what colour underpants is Andy Taylor wearing at this precise moment in time?
Probably none, because he's probably still in bed. We have had this in from, I think it's Lainey Scott.
Wow, that's good, isn't it?
Which is terrific, if you get a close-up of that. That is absolutely superb.
God, he looks better than me, doesn't he?
Isn't that wonderful?
That is really incredible.
I would thank Lainey Scott. Where's Lainey over there?
Thank you.
It's superb, isn't it? Stunning drawing. Stunning drawing, that. Right, if you grab the phones, we can take some more calls. Wow. Sarah Scott's on the line. Hello, Sarah.
Hello.
Hello, good morning. You're through to Nick and Simon.
Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
I wonder if... Do you have a hairdresser to do your hair? Or do you have a private hairdresser, or do you go to a hairdressing salon or something?
We get them for free. We get them for free because Andy's brother-in-law is a hairdresser. So yeah. we get them for nothing, which is really sneaky. A friend of mine cuts mine sometimes. A chap called Dave Mars. Hi, Dave. How you doing?
Yeah, a friend of mine cuts mine sometimes too. It's a chap called Leonard. I went to see him the other day.
And Mitchell Wilson from Wolverhampton. He's the guy who does them most of the time.
Okay. Is that all right for you?
Could you wave to my friend Darren Sarah Williams, please?
Hi.
Hi.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thanks very much for your call. Bye-bye.
Thanks.
Bye. Bye. Maria Gilligan. Good morning, Maria.
Hello.
You're through to the lads.
So can I speak to Nick, please?
Hello, Maria.
Hello. Nick, when you read things in the paper about it that aren't true or get any kind of bad publicity, does it upset you or do you just forget
about it? No, not really. I feel a little bit sorry for the sort of people that write those things because I think that when you get up every morning and you think, who am I going to write nasty things about today, it must be very depressing for them, but I don't worry about them.
Good luck with the single.
All right.
Can you say hello to Rebecca and Joanne, please?
Hello, Rebecca and Joanne.
Thanks. And okay. Say hello to John, please, from me.
I will.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks for your call. Bye. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Right, Freya, that's all the calls we've got time for. Sorry for trying to get through, but...
Isn't that it?
Sorry, but you're going to have to sit back and watch the video now. This is really going to, you know... Can you manage that?
From Duran, and that is Wild Boys. Thanks to Nick and Simon very much for coming in, taking the calls. If you couldn't get through, sorry about that. Next week, we've got a shorter programme, which finishes at 11.30 because of the Lord Mayor's show, so make sure you switch on early, starting at 9 o'clock. We've got George and Andrew live in the store from Wham! We're doing the single and chatting to you on the phones. Also next week, we have Joanna Munro coming in and a trip around the record factory that somebody won with Shakin' Stevens. We've got lots of burly American footballers, cartoons, and also the guy that went to Stockholm. You can see the pictures that he won this chess competition. And the headlines over there? Yes, we've got some headlines.
Headlines.
They've been very busy, and you're going to see them in about a year's time, the magazine Graffiti.
Really?
That's coming up soon.
Yeah,
that's
good. Well, thanks. They're going to send us a magazine.
Are
the
they?
Magazine that they've compiled from this morning.
Yes,
and
she
yes,
is a mum.
She is a mum.
Tomorrow
morning.
See you next week.
See you next week.
Give everyone a hand.